First of all, thanks for agreeing to talk to us. I've been reading Megatokyo for a very long time, actually, so I've got quite a few things I'd like to ask you.
Sure.
Absolutely. So, I'd actually like to talk to you a little bit about kind of the roots of Megatokyo, especially in the visual novel and the dating sim kind of arena, because...
Back when I started working on Megatokyo, the anime wasn't as prominent as it now became. And, you know, the concept of the dating sim or a lot of that stuff was not well known by a lot of people.
Right.
People know a lot more about it today than I did back then. But so it was kind of an interesting angle
right.
to write about and things like that. But it's like anything. You're sort of influenced by the things that you like and the things that you follow. And when I was following a lot of more along the things that you're definitely more interested in. It was kind of great to find stories and comics that dealt more with the relationships or more subtle. There's a concept that I like to talk about, when you read something or. There's sort of that everyday life kind of thing which you'll find in
right, slice of life.
Slice of life. I call them in between days. You've got the magical girl show where it's like you've got all the insane saving the earth stuff, fast forward. It's all the in between stuff where, the characters are having their sort of daily struggles that usually tend to be more interesting to me.
When did you start getting interested in it? How did you hear about it? Fans weren't really into that sort of thing.
When I was in high school, I wanted to be a Disney animator, or an animator. That's what I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
Big fans of like Don Bluth and some of the old Disney animation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a total give for my age, but back then, Disney animation industry was completely dead. There was no hope for it when I went to college.
Right.
So I went in and studied architecture. When I graduated from architecture school, The Little Mermaid came out. Signaling the return and the revival of animation in the United States, and I was just kicking myself for years. But then at the same time, I'm kind of glad I didn't go that route because I was able to sort of develop my own sort of style instead of learning how to do the Disney way.
Right.
That type of thing. So, and as far as influence go, I go to an independent comic shop and it's like, God, I want to find something. You find little gems of something that just had a little flavor of something that I liked.
Yeah.
And then I came across things like Appleseed.
Right.
And Maisonikoku was one that I came... And these were some of the first ones that were starting to come out. And it's like, oh, man, this is great. You're like reading these things like crazy. And then when I started getting on the internet, this was right before the time that America Online connected to the internet, you could do web browsing.
Right.
Okay, I'm aging myself again here.
So am I.
Because the first time I came across anime that I really was into was I rented a Urusai Yatsura DVD, a tape. They didn't have DVDs back then. It was a tape.
Right.
And at the end, there was an ad for something called Kimigori Orange Road. And I'm just like, look at this thing. I got to get this. That's what I want to watch right there. He's here. So
he's here. I was about to say, are you looking forward to meeting him then?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm nervous about it, frankly. But he's definitely one of my... Because I got to tell you, the press release had me and him on it.
Oh, yeah.
I got to tell you, 10 years ago, there's no way I would ever imagine that being something like that.
Wow.
So that's sort of where it started. And, people have asked me, how do you draw the way you do? It's like, well, I'm influenced by, these are the comics I've read, this one influenced me. So,
right.
It's a long-winded answer. I'm sorry.
That's fine. You can speak as long as you like.
Well,
until we run out of time. But the thing is that, as you said, visual novel, the culture behind visual novels, the entire style of things, has become much more predominant now than it once was, at least certainly when Megatokyo started, I think it was. I've definitely seen this shift in anime, especially in the last 10 years, and would I be wrong to actually suggest that actually your comic probably had something to do with its popularization in English-speaking countries?
Well, yeah, it's nice to think that.
I've never heard of
Key. Probably a lot of people have maybe not been exposed to Key games. I was a Key fan back in 1998, back 1999, back when Canon
first came out.
Over the years, now that the anime is out, and all of a sudden it's a big deal, and also games inspired by them. So, it's more like, I was just following the thread that other people discovered as well. I don't know. I definitely know a lot of people who know more about it than I do.
Right.
But it was just something really interesting. And that was because it's like, you know, when you get on the internet, I've always been interested in stuff that was interesting or just appealed to me. Not, oh, everybody else is doing this, so I need to sort of get into it too.
No, so definitely not.
There are a lot of people who still can't believe I haven't seen Cowboy Bebop. I haven't watched it.
Wow. Yet.
At the time, I wasn't really interested per se in it. One of these days, I'll watch it. But it like blows people away when I do.
What have you been watching lately?
Well, lately, you know, it goes in waves. Lately, when the resurgence, I mean, Gosek, it's like, I love that.
Oh, man.
I am still incredibly infuriated and pissed off at Duella Magica.
Oh, really?
I got seriously irate at that. But, and you know, it was a show that did exactly what they were trying to do.
Right.
But there's been a lot of stuff, actually, recently that's been really good and trying to sort of follow up on. Denpa Ona. I actually watched the first episode of that while I was sitting on the plane. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, wow, this is different.
Yeah.
You know, but it's like these subtle things that can be appealing.
Right.
And it depends on that. So right now, there are some things that are definitely appealing to me in the various anime for showing up.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. What we do is we do try to keep up every once in a while on our own site, and definitely.
Yeah. It like breaks off into subgenres.
Yeah,
like crazy, you know.
It really has fragments of a lot. You're right. Yeah.
I sort of skipped over the whole Haruhi thing because there were things about it that appealed to me that were very different than what appealed to everybody else. So I just didn't pay any attention.
Ah, you know? I see. Yeah.
And it's kind of nice to find what you like that appeals to you and just sort of nose your way into that.
Right.
And then you come across the big fans who like, there's like gateway questions. What color do you like? So, you know,
right.
And the elitism sort of bugs me sometimes.
Yeah.
I don't care, I can watch it without ever having to deal with you. So.
Yeah. And of course, you also were one of the original spearheads behind one of the first webcomic artists to become really popular and start actually making a living off of doing it. And
no, definitely in the manga, sort of.
And especially in the manga style, right? You know, there's Penny Arcade, of course, you know, and the thing is that, you know, what do you see as the future of webcomics? You've been in this business for quite a long time now, 10 years, and you know, also, and for the whole movement of original English language manga in general. Yeah.
Well, I think one of the problems that original English language manga had was, you know, you had this explosion of popularity of manga, and there were all these series that they were publishing, and you get, you know, 2, 3, 4 volumes of these things.
Right.
You know, the thing that, and it works for me, because I'm releasing things one at a time, a group at a time. And it was really hard for a lot of newer OEL artists to put together an entire book
right at
once. And I could not do that myself. And it made it a lot harder. You don't get that testing that you get. Because, you know, especially with, you know, with regular comics, you know, you get 14 pages at a time to come out.
Right.
And then it, you know, it'd be successful. You'd be able to see what works, what doesn't. And then you have a book that collects it. So, you know, the nice thing about the web is that it's, you can get on there, you can show your work, anybody can read it.
Right.
I didn't do manga type work beforehand because doing a little monthly comic book to put in a comic book shop, wrong audience. I mean, you wouldn't reach the people who might read it.
Exactly.
The web enabled me to reach people who could read it. So, you know, we went through the whole bookstore thing, and now there's this whole e-publishing thing where I'm sort of poking my fingers at that just to sort of see how things may or may not work. You know, it all comes down to if you get the combination right, and if people are, because, you know, a lot of people like to read stuff. They like to read stuff for free. They're used to getting it for free or
right.
not too expensive. You know, what are people, at what point do people like the idea of paying for it? Or is it convenient or whatever? So it's, you know, everything changes.
Yeah.
So, you know, you try to work with it. But it's definitely very possible for people who want to do it get into it.
Oh, okay.
And if you don't get popular, you know, it's not because you're not quote-unquote good, it's because it depends on how many people like what you're doing.
Right, and so you would say kind of the web, or becoming first a web comic artist might be kind of a good entry point.
Oh, absolutely.
Rather than
there's nothing to stop you from doing it. And, you know, and if it's good, people will find it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how it works. I never advertised, I never pushed.
Right.
Word of mouth is the way things get around.
Exactly, yeah. And so, how much, roughly speaking, do you depend on the merchandising aspect of it as well?
Well, I mean, my thing was that I always did the webcomic for free.
Right.
It was all up there for free, the following it. And then you get a percentage of people who would buy merchandise.
Right.
There's advertising, there's where you get the books out and have those coming every once in a while. And this, that was sort of the model of how it works, you know.
Right.
And it comes and it goes. You know, the economy goes down, people, you know, start buying less. And, you know, you may come up with a great idea for a shirt. And,
yeah.
I mean, we actually make our own shirts.
Okay.
I have a kind of a fancy...
You have this new custom one.
It's a, well, that's not custom, but it's a digital, it's a direct garment. So we actually,
right.
So when you order a shirt, I actually print the things.
Wow, literally,
you know,
yeah.
Literally. I mean, this weighting, it does white and then it does blue. So, and that takes time, too. So,
yeah.
You know, if you get a lot of orders, next thing you know, you're spending a lot of time printing, and but you have to do that because that's where people are paying for something. This was webcomics free, you know. A three-year-old on top of it.
Oh, yeah, exactly. A lot of pressure there.
Yeah, so it's a balancing act. And I don't always, in fact, I don't always do a very good job. Recently this year, things have been really slow because you threw my wife and cancer into the mix. And, you know, you put all of those. Yeah, she's doing well. She's doing really well. So that was one of those, you know, the big arc of finding out and dealing with and educating and then doing the treatments and,
right.
And you sort of get on the other side of that. It's,
yeah.
I'm over on the other side.
I just remember the Cafe Press days, and I think I bought that portrait artist T-shirt. Actually, I've always gotten some strange looks if I ever wear them. Because yeah, that was very amusing. So.
I love when people try to get me to explain this shirt. And say, do I have to?
Baka baka.
Yep. Yeah. It's really sad when you're like, yeah, that's from Rudy from Nadeshko, and
right.
People would be like, who's that? And I'm just going.
90s anime.
Yeah. Yeah. King of Orange Road, that's a while ago, so you know,
yeah.
But when people don't know what, you know, what Nadeshko is, I'm just like, oh my god,
gotten their roots. Exactly.
Roots, kids.
Yeah, that's my generation of fans. So.
Yeah, there's a lot of younger people getting in. They're jumping in on what's available now. So
yeah.
It's, you know, it's to be expected.
The horror heat folks are the people going through the lab, and that's exactly.
Yeah. I love bringing up shows that people, you know, have never heard of. In fact, sometimes people who went through that genre.
Yeah.
Like I bring up one of my old favorites, Hell Teacher Rube. That was great stuff. And people like, and they look it up and it's like, what the hell is this? Which is,
A couple of years ago, you switched to using a Cintiq tablet, right? One of the ones with the screen on it.
Yep.
How has that affected the way you do your art?
It has made a lot of things easier.
Oh.
It has not changed the way I draw. In fact, I can interchangeably go back and forth because the way that I have it set up, the feel and the output. If I do something by hand, by penciling something on a Cintiq, they really look very similar. The only difference you might see is that with the hand drawn one, you can see more artifacting, more smudging, texture. You know, and that's the thing, when you're doing it on paper, you know, you have to be very careful. There's a lot of things you can deal with. Scanning is a pain. You know, also taking your image and resizing or moving. When you're working on doing layers on Cintiq and whatnot, I mean, it's really nice to be able to like move things around. You can be a lot cleaner, you can get a lot more detailed. I mean, I definitely like doing it.
Does that
of course,
mean-
my son.
Yes,
he liked to draw on it too. And he grabbed the stylus one day. He grabbed that mechanical pencil and started drawing on it. And I wasn't there, and the pencil that went down.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was plastic, or it was metal. And then he started scratching the circle. So,
see.
Well, $200 repair. So, yeah.
I got a few more just quick questions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Real quick.
Yeah, these are fun questions. Yeah. So, no.
It is time.
All right.
Okay.
All right, though, I guess I don't have anything except maybe. Would Ping and Hatsune Miku get along, or would they have a fight?
You're going to find out this chapter. Let's put it that way.
All right, excellent. Excellent.
All right, great.